Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you, Pearl, for such a kind introduction. I don't quite know how you live up to all those kind things, but I do want to emphasize what Kathy said. This is really a collaborative venture that has grown out of a number of areas of thought and practical developments over the past few decades. For example, our technologies in terms of imaging the brain, the work done by Dr. Lozano and Dr. Tony Lang and other colleagues using the technique of deep brain stimulation in Parkinson's disease was really a very significant aspect. And the thinking about the way a brain might look in a depressed state compared to a non-depressed state, the work developed by Dr. Helen Mayberg, who's been, in fact, a key member of this team and is now a professor at Emory in Atlanta, Georgia. So there are many people who've participated along the way. We've had psychiatry, neurology, neurosurgery, nursing, and many other allied health groups, and I think it really speaks to the importance of our multidisciplinary approaches. Now, I think it's probably a good place to start to spell out exactly what depression is, and many people have trouble with the concept of depression as a brain disease. And I don't want to be flippant, but people often make reference to a bad hair day in terms of mood. When we talk about a depressive illness, we're talking about a degree of suffering that is at an extreme level. And I have no doubt that if I got into personal conversation with anybody in this room, there will be a family member, the person himself or herself, or a co-worker who will have suffered from depression at a level of impairment. Now, I think I could show you slides that would come from textbooks and publications, but the best way to really make this point, I think, is to ask one of our patients. And I want to acknowledge Rob, who is, in fact, as you will hear, one of the people who've received deep brain stimulation. And I'd like to let Rob tell you, essentially, what it's been like for him.
Rob, I really want to thank you for allowing me to use this brief material for educational purposes and essentially to let people in our hospital community know about it. Can you just start by asking when did you actually have deep brain stimulation? October of 03. Okay, could you give me a sense of what you felt like going into what was at that point a relatively pioneering, in fact still is a pioneering, surgery for depression?
I didn't think it would work. I was convinced that anything else that wouldn't work. So I thought, well, I have no other choices, really. Clinically, I'm a psychiatrist. It's something to do.
What was it actually like going through the surgery?
The actual surgery? It's pretty horrible. It's like all the pain in your whole life in one day. It's really painful. But it's worth it.
And what was it like in the few days after the surgery?
It took them a couple days to find the setting that worked best for me. Some of them made me feel worse. Some of them made me feel better. Some of them made me feel too hyper. You know, they fiddled around. And it just, it's not like it instantly made me happy. It took things away that were, you know, I've said this before, it was like I was awake again.
Contrast the last 3 years to the 3 years before you had the surgery?
I was pretty convinced that I was going to die, that there was nothing left for me. I had completely, my life had completely closed in. I had no friends. I wasn't working. I couldn't work. All I did was lay in bed for days. Sometimes I'd sleep, sometimes I wouldn't really eat. And when I did, I ate ice cream and sweet things.
So fast forward to the last 3 years, what's the thing on that
you know, I'm working full time.
And you've been back at work for?
I've been on payroll for just over a year. I've been back May 2005, which was probably the most terrifying thing I've ever done.
How long had you been off work on disability before you?
2.5 years.
And you were able to get back and maintain full-time work over the last 18 months?
Yes. It was very, well, you know, you were with me when we were going through this, and you know how scared I was. And my colleagues at work, they didn't think I was going to ever come back. And human resources figured I never would come back. The important thing that it did for me was it sort of took away the pulling of the depression, the emptiness, the despair. I'm glad that I don't have to worry about it.
You're just getting on with life.
Yeah, like it. I'm planning things, I've done things, it's like physically in my...
Well, I thank Rob for allowing me to show that, and I think it makes the point about depression in terms of the kind of symptoms, the cluster of symptoms, the impact that these symptoms have on a person's life, and the persistence of them. So I'm going to, in the rest of this presentation, essentially make 5 points, and you can see these points here. Depression is everywhere. Depression is an extremely expensive condition in society. Depression is lethal. Depression is treatable. And depression is a brain disease. Now, in terms of the prevalence, we know a number of things, whether we look at studies in Canada, Australia, Australasia, Europe, that women have depression roughly twice as often as men. And if we take a year and we ask about rates of depression, roughly 10% of women and 5% of men will have had a depressive episode where these symptoms have persisted and need treatment in the past year. If we ask about a lifetime, 1 in 5 to 1 in 7 women will have had a significant depressive episode, and 1 in 10 men will have had a depressive episode. So depression is prevalent. These are the figures from hospital or general practice visits in Canada in 2004. Over 3 million patient visits. And you can see that, in fact, almost 10 million of those visits were actually due to depression. And over 5 million were due to anxiety. So only hypertension and diabetes resulted in higher frequency of visits. And remember, depression coexists with many of these disorders.